All right, well, good evening, everyone. My name is Brian Lapsa, and on behalf of the Leuven Newman Society, welcome to this third installment of our Faith and Reason lecture discussion series of this year. If you're not familiar with the Leuven Newman Society, we're an organization that has as its goal to provide an academic forum for the discussion of questions of interest to the Catholic faith. If you'd like to know more, there are some flyers on the windowsill back there, as well as a sign-up sheet if you want to receive our weekly email newsletters. You can also find us on Facebook or on our website, which you can find on the flyers around the table. Our guest this evening is Professor Paul Richard Blum. I'm very happy to have him here. He comes to us from Loyola University, Maryland. Prior to that, he studied, at the beginning of his career, I suppose, studied philosophy, German literature, at various cities in Germany, as well as in Italy, if I'm not mistaken, before writing his dissertation on Giordano Bruno. Later, he taught at Munich and Berlin, as well as in Budapest, and since 2002 he's had the T.J. Higgins Chair for Philosophy at Loyola. He's also a member of various international academic associations in Germany, Hungary, United States, Italy, including the Pontifical Academy of St. Thomas Aquinas in Rome. So we're very honored to have him here this evening. Most of his research touches areas related to what he'll be talking to us about tonight, namely Renaissance philosophy, so Bruno, Ficino, Pico della Mirandola, many others. So a warm welcome to Professor Blum, and we're all looking forward to it, so welcome.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure and an honor to speak to this group of, which I hadn't heard before, but you come to places to learn new stuff. Yeah, so thank you very much. I must say that actually the more competent person to speak about this topic in Leuven would be Gerge Bokos, who several years ago wrote his PhD thesis on the Pace Fidei of Nicolas of Cusa, and it was published in 2010 at Pickwick Press in Eugene, Oregon. I'm in contact with Gerge, and I asked him for permission to show the video clip with which I want to open talk and discussion this evening. So can you show it to them? It's from a German monthly news show, Die Anstalt, meaning the manicomio, the madhouse. There is a French, actually Hungarian by origin, French comic, Alphonse, who says something about peace of religion. And it's in German, we might summarize later for those who don't understand.
Überall, es hat in Paris geknallt, es knallt momentan wirklich überall. Und meistens knallt es wegen Religion. Also ich habe immer gedacht, Religion, das ist Toleranz, das ist Respekt, das ist Liebe. Habe ich damals was falsch verstanden? Ja, das kann sein. Ich war immer sehr naiv, meine Damen und Herren. Wissen Sie, dass ich so ganz lange, ich habe gedacht, Tour de France hat was mit Sport zu tun. Madame Perra, Sie kennen, oder? Madame Perra? Nein? Also wenn wir die deutsch-französische Freundschaft auf Vordermann bringen wollen, Sie müssen sich ein bisschen für Frankreich interessieren, ja? Madame Perra, das war meine Lehrerin von der 5. Klasse. Und Madame Perra, sie hat uns gesagt, wisst ihr was, kleine Kinder, in dieser Klasse gibt es ganz viele verschiedene Religionen und es funktioniert wunderbar. Also wenn es hier funktioniert, gibt es keinen Grund, warum es auf der ganzen Welt nicht funktionieren könnte. Auch das habe ich geglaubt. Das stimmt auch wirklich. Wir hatten überhaupt keine Probleme. Es gab Katholiken, es gab Muslime, es gab Protestanten, es gab Juden. Ich war normal. Einmal, Madame Perras hat uns gesagt, wir machen ein kleines Experiment. Ihr seid vielleicht noch ein bisschen zu klein, aber wir versuchen es. Wir machen einen Philosophieunterricht zum Thema Hass. Und dann hat sie uns gefragt, Kinder, habt ihr schon jemals jemanden gehasst? Nein. Es wäre uns auch nie im Sinn gekommen, Hier denn jemand zu hassen, die dann seine Religion, also Einigkeit, dass wir auch Kilometer weit entfernt von uns haben, außer den Zahnarzt natürlich, aber das ist ja normal, der Arzt verdient, wissen wir nicht. In Frankreich, wir haben einen Schulzahnarzt, das heißt, wir gehen die ganze Klasse zusammen zum Zahnarzt und wir hatten einen Zahnarzt, der war, oh, wir haben ihn wirklich nicht gemacht. Der Typ, der hat sich in alles eingemischt, zum Beispiel. Es gab vor der Schule ein Süßigkeitsautomat. Wissen Sie, wofür er sich durchgesetzt hat? Er hat sich durchgesetzt, dass der Süßigkeitsautomat gebaut werden sollte, damit nur noch die Eltern und nicht mehr die Kinder das erreichen. Ein Vollidiot, der Typ. Und Madame Perra, als sie das erfahren hat, hat sie gesagt, das ist interessant. Hausaufgabe für nächste Woche, versucht den Zahnarzt nicht mehr zu hassen. Und dann sagte sie noch, kleiner Tipp. Für diejenigen, die eine Religion haben, sucht in eurer Religion. Sucht in eurer Religion, es kann sein, dass ihr da was findet. Gut, wir haben uns getroffen und die Katholiken und die Protestanten, die haben ihre Bibel dann mitgebracht. Der Jude seine Tora, der Muslim sein Koran, ich meine Übshefte. Dann haben wir angefangen zu suchen, was könnte da passen für den Zahnarzt, aber wir haben nichts gefunden, alles gesucht. Doch ein Ding haben wir gefunden, da stand Auge um Auge, Zahn um Zahn. Aber noch, also. Wir haben gedacht, gut, das könnte passen zum Zahnarzt, aber es könnte genauso passen zum Optiker, also das wird nicht. Wir haben nichts gefunden, meine Damen und Herren, und jeden Tag, wir gingen an dem Süßigkeitsautomat vorbei, und jeden Tag, wir konnten das Ding nicht erreichen, und deshalb, der Hass für den Zahnarzt, das war noch größer, das war genau das Gegenteil von dem, was Madame Perra wollte. Bis zu dem Teil, wo wir eine Idee hatten. Wir haben die Bibel auf die Tora gelegt und dann auf den Koran und noch zwei, vielleicht drei Ausgaben von den Übshäften. Dann sind wir so ganz langsam und vorsichtig drauf gestiegen. Und tatsächlich konnten wir wieder den Süßigkeitsautomat erreichen. Wissen Sie, was passiert ist? Auf einmal, der Hass für den Zahnarzt war komplett weg. Und da haben wir verstanden, Moment mal, jetzt ist es klar, was Madame Perra immer sagt. Wenn Religionen zusammenhalten, dann gibt es für alles eine Lösung.
Okay, so that is Piece of Religion, 21st Century, French-German version. Probably most of you understood the point. The question was the kids, school kids, hated their dentist, not only because he's a dentist, but also because he had decreed that the candy machine is put that high that they can't reach it, and the kids couldn't reach it. And so the teacher had instructed them to look in their religious books whether there's anything about how to hate someone. And of course, for the Americans, we all know an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, but that was as close as they could get to hating someone. You hear my pause. And then they figured out that they could use those holy books to step on them and then to reach the candy box. And that was, at the same time, the end of hating the dentist. On a more serious note, let me introduce you a few thoughts about peace and religious peace. The first question I would ask, what is peace? And maybe peace is simply something like a weakness. Or is it a power? Or is it maybe something like an entropy? When my brain shuts down, most of the activities and my body reduces the tonus, I'm sleeping. And if that goes a few steps further, then we call that death. Standing upright is, physically speaking, an unstable equilibrium. It takes a lot of energy to keep standing, thinking and talking. Death, in that sense, in physical sense, is a stable equilibrium. Entropy tends to a stable equilibrium. So then the question is peace a matter of force or an unstable equilibrium, or rather the result of entropy when all people stopped fighting? Armistice is one form of not fighting. In English, the term truce with C, the Italian tregua, are the words for armistice. Both words are related to the word trust, in German, Treue. Treue and tregua in the Middle Ages meant the relationship between the king and his vassals. You don't attack me, and in exchange I care for you. And that was a mutual relationship. All of these words, Treue, Tregua, Trust, are related to truth. The motto of the Catholic University in Hungary, where I taught before coming to Loyola, comes from the coat of arms of its founder, Peter Pasman, Veritas cum Fidelitate, truth with faithfulness. There is no truth where there is no trust. Truth and trust call for truth. Comes in religion. Religion, among many other things, is a truth claim. And to make a long story short, frequently, while defending the claim, people forget the truth about it. This brings us to the question, can there be a religious war? While fighting for a truth, how is it possible to hold this truth upright? The truth of religion is absolute. Struggle is obviously a matter of instability, a very unstable equilibrium. Does not the truth of religion, does not God inherently call for a truce, an armistice? Can truthfulness to the truth do other than rest in peace? Or, to use the motto of Cardinal Newman, holiness before peace. Is the strife for holiness in opposition to peace or a necessary condition for it? Let us now briefly think about the current events. And this video clip was, as you might have observed, aired a week after the attack in Paris. I will not pontificate over the events themselves because I don't know much more than anybody else who reads newspapers. Is it possible that the terrorists have religion in mind? Do warfare and terror attacks foster truth, truce, faith? Or is it the other way around? Does religious truth undo the truce? Prominent critics of religion, like the late Christopher Hitchens, think so. The test scenario would be a world without religion, or at least an a-religious country like Albania before 1990. Is that likely to be at eternal peace? This Alphonse didn't say we don't need religion, he said we need cooperation of religion. That was his message. The fact of religious warfare and terrorism with sectarian implications stems from the claiming of that truth. Whenever people make a claim, they appropriate it as though it could not belong to any other person or group. That works well with a material property, like a land or a wealth. But how is it possible to claim a truth? religious war turns the power of claiming inside out. While truth should be trusted to be shared with everyone, here it is partitioned. Sectarian. Religious terrorists are at war with those who do not share their religion, as though religion could be a possession. They fight others for not having, they fight others not for a thing to gain, but for the accusation that the others do not have what they have. The problem is that we cannot think of religion as an object that can be had or missed. Therefore, we cannot possibly trust the truth of religious warriors. I'm thinking of the Catholic and Protestant armies during the 30 Years' War, or of Charlemagne christening the Saxons, or generally the two swords theory of the Middle Ages, when people of the Church thought the truth of the Bible had to be spread both through missionaries and by crusades. And the most important philosopher in this respect was Raymond Lull, who on the one hand implored the popes to start another crusade, and at the same time had a wonderful program of educating the Muslims and doing mission. So these are my considerations before we look a little bit into the text, and I do not expect that you all read the text, but I will read or have someone read parts of it. The story of the book itself is pretty easy. In 1453, the Turks conquered Byzantium, Constantinople, and Nicolas of Cusa heard of it and wrote this treatise, De Pace Fidei, on the peace of religion, whatever it of means. As he mentioned, we will see that in a minute. He had been in Constantinople himself personally. He was kind of personally invested in this affair. That's for the time being enough. You need to know. The treatise is comparatively short. But it has a very strange form, namely it is written as a vision, as you will see. It has three major parts, this kind of prologue, which is pretty long. Then it has chapters 4 to 19, a discussion of various religious problems in form of dialogue, yeah, you get the point. And finally then an epilogue, which is very short and very surprising, at least I believe so. So the central part, the discussions about various issues of religion, have three major topics. The one is the oneness, which is God and wisdom. The second would be the problem of Trinity. And the third then would be Christology. We can look at that if you wish. You will have seen if you had a chance to look at the text. You will have seen that the text is in part very technical, but then on the other hand also very technical in the sense of it is discussing theological debates that even today are current questions of professional theology, but also it has very practical aspects, and they come in at very surprising moments, and we might take a look at that. And the question in mind is, as I said in my opening, the question is religious war not perhaps a contradiction in terms? Or on the other hand, the other way around, is maybe religion the beginning of strife, of quarrels, of division. If we take a look at the text itself, maybe I see you have a text. May I ask you to read for us the paragraph one?
Sure.
Yeah. So that people can get a feeling of it, those who didn't have the time to read it or don't have the text available, and then we can talk about it.
There was a certain man who, having formerly seen the sights in the regions of Constantinople, was inflamed with zeal for God as a result of those deeds that were reported to have been perpetrated at Constantinople, most recently and most cruelly by the King of the Turks. Consequently, with many groanings, he beseeched the Creator of all, because of his kindness, to restrain the persecution that was raging more fiercely than usual on account of the difference of right between the religions. It came to pass that after a number of days, perhaps because of his prolonged, incessant meditation, a vision was shown to the same zealous man. Therefrom he adduced the following: the few wise men who are rich in the experiential knowledge of all such differences as are observed throughout the world in the different religions can find a single, readily available harmony. And through this harmony there can be constituted, by a suitable and true means, perpetual peace within the domain of religion. Hence, in order that this vision might one day become known to those who have a say in these especially important matters, he wrote down plainly in what follows as much of it as he recalled.
Okay, thank you. A word about the translation. This translation is done by Jasper Hopkins, who certainly will merit a place in heaven somewhere for having done that work of translating almost all of Cusanus into English. However, a few years in purgatory are in order for some weaknesses of that translation. One thing is, he doesn't trust himself, so whenever he thinks he needs to, or his readers are too stupid to understand the reference of something, he puts it in brackets, like within the domain of religion. Who cares? Yeah. So in most cases, you can simply skip those square brackets because they are just additions that are, for an intelligent reader, obvious. Sometimes he adds things without square brackets, and then I'm really mad at him. But still, after the purgatory, he deserves a place in heaven, I would say, if I were the promoter of his canonization. I don't even know whether he's Catholic or not. Anyway, so, yeah. The opening scene is first person. He speaks in third person, but it's a first person approach. That's very interesting. Yeah, religion, everybody knows it today, is a personal matter. Yes, war is a personal matter. Yes, therefore, if we talk about religion, if we talk about war and peace, there's nothing wrong with saying, yes, I am part of the story. Yeah. So he says about himself that he had been in Constantinople, and that's why he was particularly shocked by the brutality of this war. Nicolas of Cusa had been a, for those who don't know his story, had been a church diplomat from his early career on. He was at the Council of Basel, and after the Council of Basel, he was invited to, he was delegated to travel to Byzantium in order to gather and accompany a delegation of Byzantine scholars and politicians to the council of the continuation of the Basel Council, which was then in Ferrara and then in Florence. And Some of you might have met John Monfasani. We have a discussion about the question whether Cusanus met all those people in person, and I would say, how could he not have met them in person? Because it was his job to meet them and to talk with them. So some of their thought, of the Byzantine scholars' thought, certainly must have influenced Nicolas of Cusa. That is one part of the story. About the council, it is important, that was in 1438-39, that is, the Ottoman Empire was already pressing on the Asia Minor, and was making had success, and Byzantium was under pressure, was in danger, and therefore the Eastern and the Western diplomats had the great idea to make a council and to reunite the two churches, the Eastern and the Western Church, in order to gain more power and also military strength. Theologically, probably a disaster. Philosophically, extremely important, because that was the opening of the entrance of Neoplatonic thought into Italy and into the Western Latin-speaking realm of Europe at that time. But that's another story. So Nicolas of Cusa opens the question, opens the debate about peace and religion with reference to his own personal experience. I think that's a very important thing, and we should not forget that when we discuss about quotas for refugees, controlling everybody who is passing the borders between France and Belgium and Belgium and Germany, and so we should never forget that we are dealing with individual persons, with real people. That is one part of the story. The other thing is this extreme contrast between the visionary and the practical. Yeah. to restrain the persecution that was raging more fiercely than usual on account of the difference of right between the religions. Did you hear that? More fiercely than usual. Yeah. and then he says, after a number of days of meditation, he had a vision that changed his zealous attitude. Because zeal is another key word, is another very important key word. I'm looking for a quotation. Which I had written down somewhere, but now I don't find it. Strange. Here it is. In a letter to John of Segovia, who had written a treatise on how to deal with Muslims, how to deal with the Quran, said, no, yeah, Nicolas of Cusa, in a letter to John of Segovia, says, nam lung fidei orthodoxe defensio exigebat talem zelosum adque aprime doctum per acutum et memorativum reperiri. The defense of the right faith requires a zealous, learned, and sharp-minded person. Yeah. Zeal is practical, but it has to be combined with a vision, with learnedness, with insight. Yeah. If zeal is wrongheaded, it becomes dangerous. So. So that is one aspect of this opening. The personal, the practical, and the visionary, all those go together in the question of peace of religion. So the story goes on that that the King of Heaven and Earth said, from the kingdom of this world, sorrowing messengers had conveyed to him the moanings of the oppressed. There is nothing incidental in Nicolas of Cusa. His Latin is not very classical and is also not very scholastic, but it is a very deliberate Latin. So the translation is okay here. The King of Heaven and Earth said that from the kingdom of this world, sorrowing messengers had conveyed him the moanings of the oppressed. That for the sake of religion, very many people were in armed conflict with one another, and that by physical force, men were either compelling others to renounce their long adhered to a religious sect, or were inflicting death. The stage is that God sees that the world is misbehaving, and the world is creating sorrow and sorrow and strife and wars. Then comes the term messenger. That looks pretty innocent, but in Nicolas of Cusa's compendium, one of his later works, which is also one of my favorite works of Nicolas of Cusa, he uses the metaphor of the messenger to explain an epistemological, semiotic, and theological point. He says, imagine a geographer who is writing, who is designing a map of the world, and he sends his five messengers out to tell him what the world is like. Then he closes the doors, puts all these messages together, and then he observes himself observing and creating a map of the world. And this is a simile of how God created the world. So the relationship between God and world is not that simply of a maker and a thing made. It is it's a semiotic relationship. It's a relationship of signification. So if you have that in mind, that he's using messenger in an epistemological sense, then what it is saying is God is realizing, or God is in the presence of the world being disturbed and being in conflict. Or on a more abstract level, religion and peace are practical problems, yes, but they are also conceptual problems. How do we think when we think in terms of religion, and how do we think when we think in terms of war or peace? What is implied? And that is, I would say, great deal of the remainder of this text. Can I ask you once again to read for us section 3, that part after that, where that footnote 4 starts, that intellectual spirit, or maybe before that, from one man. Can you find it?
Sure. Yeah. From one man there was multiplied the great number of people who inhabit the surface of dry land. That intellectual spirit, planted on earth and absorbed within a shadow, does not see the light and the first stages of its origin. Nevertheless, you created with it all those things through which it, when stimulated by an appreciative desire for the things it attains unto through the senses, can at some time raise the eyes of its mind unto you, the creator of all, and can be reunited with you in supreme love. and in this way, at long last, it can return intrusion to its origin.
Yeah. So a person is addressing addressing God, and what is he saying? You created with it all those things which it, the world, can at some time raise the eyes of its mind unto you, the Creator and all, and can be reunited with you in supreme love, and in this way, it can return to fruition of its origin. I hope it is convincing that we are continuing this semiotic relationship between God and his creation. Yeah. The reflection on the world is also a reflection about God. So let me see the next step which we should look at. Just a second. I'm sorry. The section 4 ends with the observation: the earthly human condition has this characteristic, namely, that long-standing custom, which is regarded as having passed over into nature, is defended as the truth. In this way, there arise great quarrels when each community prefers its own faith or to another. So after having said that, oh yes, we are happy to revere God, the Creator, we come to the observation that the human condition is such that that humans have customs, and out of customs they have also a truth claim, and this truth claim is then the origin of the quarrels. Let me check the next interesting point. So we are still in the prologue, yeah? So a proposal is made that, I'm coming to section 6, and maybe again we could, I could ask you to, can you read it again? The entire section 6.
If you ordain to do the foregoing, the sword will cease, as will also the malice of hatred and all evils, and all men will know that there is only one religion and a variety of rites.
That is the standard formula that you always find quoted. That's what Cusanus advertises: one religion in a variety of rites.
But perchance this difference of rites cannot be eliminated, or perhaps it is not expedient that it be eliminated, in order that the diversity may make for an increase of devotion, since each region will devote more careful attention to making its ceremonies more favorable, as it were, to you, the king. If so, then at least let there be one religion, just as you are one, and one true worship of you as sovereign. Therefore, be placable, O Lord, because your wrath is your graciousness and your justice is your mercy. Spare your weak creatures, we your envoys, whom you have granted to your people as guardians, and whom you behold here in your presence, suppliantly pray your majesty herefore, with every manner of prayer possible to us.
I would like to invite you for comments on this passage. There are a number of issues in this text. Maybe someone can comment on it, maybe someone who has the text available.
It seems that Cusanus approves of a certain degree of religious strife here.
He approves that there is at least a diversity of religions.
Yes, there's also a kind of competition between them.
Yeah, very good, yeah.
And competition is a kind of strife.
Yeah, very good, yeah.
same time he doesn't appear to think that all different of these kinds of religions will make God happy, because he says your wrath is your graciousness. He doesn't appear to mind that God gets angry sometimes.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, there is something wrong with it, you know. So if we take that together, so in some way competition is acceptable, and because in God wrath is graciousness, or say mercy, yeah.
Should we understand as his standard claim one religion and a variety of rites? What is it, does he really mean that the difference among the choosing Christians and Muslims is only a ritual difference? But then what does he mean by ritual? Does it exclude doctrinal differences? Or?
That is the topic of the rest of the of the dialogues. Yes, absolutely. That is striking. That is surprising, both probably for... Yeah, for sterner defenders of one religion, of their own religion, and it is also surprising in the context of the times. Yes, absolutely. Because you would immediately say, or smell, oh, he's selling out religion. Yeah, he's selling out all the particularities, you know. Yeah, absolutely. So, but on the other hand, then... the justification is that it increases devotion. So the oneness of the religion would be then the devotion in that, and the devotion for God may have many forms.
That may also cause the the more fiercely than usual persecution, that kind of devotion.
We're in the middle of the conflict. Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So. And of course, I would always say, can you quantify devotion? Because I mean, is it more devotion or less devotion, or is God more happy if more people probably not, yeah. So this is a very, very complicated and complex thing. To your question about wrath and graciousness or mercy, and he also says then justice is mercy, you know. It's a short reminder that in God all attributes are on one level; they are the same. So, if God is angry, if God is zealous or is punishing, if this cannot be in any contradiction with his mercy, with his graciousness, with his lenience, yeah. That has been theorized by this Raymond Lull, whom I mentioned earlier, you know, that in God all names, all attributes are interchangeable because they are taken to the absolute level. You call that apophatic theology. Yeah. So, yes, if God is wrathful, then God is at the same time peaceful. And if God is just, he is at the same time merciful. Contemporary of Nicolas of Cusa, Lorenzo Valla wrote a treatise on free will. Free will is in one element mentioned also in this text, in which Lorenzo Valla said that the identity of justice and mercy in God is something that is humanly not understandable. We cannot calculate it, we cannot put it into propositional terms. We have to accept that this is something that cannot be understood because it is on the level of the absolute, and the absolute is not something that is fathomable to a human mind. Yeah. I'm just hinting at the fact that there is a contemporary debate about the properties of God, and that can be named, and that has practical consequences. Yeah. So, you want to say something?
Yeah, I would like to say two things. One is that Islam itself, before it became belligerent in the beginning, Mohammed was speaking about the three books, which would be the Old Testament, the New Testament, and the Quran, in terms of this being the truth as God reveals it to different peoples in different languages. So, at the onset, there was this idea of tolerance and diversity in Islam, which then, for historical reason, was pushed into the background and all but punished. The other thing is about the rights, Augustine writes about the rites as being the symbolical actions to which things that are in themselves not sensible are made sensible, and therefore, of course, the rites are interchangeable. The rites are, a stand-in for the truth, but not the truth itself. So I think these two thoughts can illuminate, first of all, that Cusanus is not the only human being who thinks in these terms about about the embodiment of faith in right or in devotion. And also the necessity for all people to make unsensible things sensible, and even more, for most people, the unsensible things only become accessible in the rites, in the devotion, in the physical expressions of the non-physical content.
Yeah, okay, thanks. Yeah, maybe we come back to this. So there are passages in the text that go in this direction, yes. So, but we take the challenge, you know, we are thinking of religion, we are thinking of religion that also needs expression in human terms, and we see the problem that this can, that on the one hand should be appreciated by God, should be accepted by God. On the other hand, it can be the source of war, which is not acceptable to God. Yeah. Let us see. I mentioned already that in this paragraph is also included this dialectical relationship between piety and zeal, you know, or ira. You know, you cannot say it's a contradiction, but it is something that is conditioning each other. A high degree of piety leads also to a high degree of zeal, and a high degree of zeal can lead to something, to acts that are not pious. Yeah, and that is a dialectical relationship, I would say. So then, after this long prologue, the text goes now on and presents a number of representatives of areas of the world and or religions or denominations. It starts with the Greek, and I'm pretty sure that he is now referring to Gemistos Platon, one of those Greek scholars whom he had accompanied from Byzantium to Padua to Ferrara. This Gemistos Platon was not a priest, he was a layperson, and he advocated a return to the ancient Greek mythology as the foundation of religion, because their philosophy and ethics, that is practical life, and theology would be reunited. His book is called Nomoi, Traité des Lois, in the French edition of the 19th century. Very important text, a long story about this. Bottom line, he was not a Christian. He was a pagan, a deliberate neo-pagan, definitely. But the point the Greek is making here is that faith is not about otherness, but faith is about sameness. Yeah. To believe in something is not to believe in something that is other, but it is to believe in something that we annul. And if we annul it, it is also the same for everybody. It cannot be yours and yours and yours and mine, as the ordinary parlance goes today. That's what you believe, that's what I believe. No, believing means believing in something that is the same. And that is a Neoplatonic idea which he might have taken from Gemisus Platon. Then follows a humanist, an Italian, and I believe it is a combination of a humanist and a scholastic, because it is the discourse is geared at someone who knows about dialectical argumentation and linguistic argumentation. Then follows a Muslim. And the Muslim, the Arab, says something to the effect that to believe is to realize that wisdom depends on the presupposition of transcendentals. That is the one deity principle, salvation. So that is an enormous leap, and Cusanus has the Arab say that. The Arab might be Al-Farabi or Avicenna or Averroes or just any Arab, that is any religious Arab. He has him say, if we believe in something, we believe in something that is transcendent. And that has to be said. You know, to believe, and therefore inherently to believe, to have a faith, a religious faith, also already presupposes that there is a level beyond the ordinary. Then follows the Indian, who addresses the question of idolatry and the question of priesthood. And he speaks about the inevitableness of manifestations, visible manifestations of religion. So Cusanus has an Indian say that. For whatever reason. And then comes the Chaldean. The Chaldean is referring to the distance between the uneducated and the theologians. Later, towards the end, the Tatar is taking up this argument again. So the question of religion is also a question of highbrow and lowbrow education. Yeah, is a question of practice of people who have actual real problems in this life, and monks, philosophers, theologians who have time and leisure and space to meditate about lofty arguments. That's the argument of the Chaldean, and the arguments he's using are resonating again the theory of Raymond Lull, who had this theory of the predicates of God, and that you could say that everything there is a predicate of God. Yeah. And also the question of fertility and creativity of God. God, in Lull and in others, but especially in Lull, and then Cusanus taking up this idea, is God is transcendent, yes, but not idle. God is creative. God is fertile. And therefore it doesn't make sense. Therefore we have to be aware that God is creating a world, that God is manifesting himself in a visible world, in a tangible world. And that goes of course along with rites in the visible sense, and also priesthood and so in a practical sense. Since we are speaking about Raymond Lull and Muslims at this point, let me tell a story. It's actually two stories. Raymond Lull lived around 1300. He was a lay person and had the fabulous idea, as I mentioned, to convert the Muslims in northern Africa. He was born in Mallorca before the German tourists were there. He was born in Mallorca, an island that had the presence of three religions there. There were many Jews, there were many Muslims, there were many Catholic Christian Spaniards there. He had this bright idea to do spiritual mission to the Muslims, and for that purpose he hired a servant or slave, a Muslim, to teach him Arabic. One day the Arab teacher spoke up and made some negative remarks about Trinity and incarnation and so on, and they came to an argument and they came to blows, and Lull beat him up and then put him into prison, and it was obvious from the code of situation of that time that he had to put him to death. So Raymond retired for 3 days into prayers, and when he came back, he passed by the prison where the slave was imprisoned, and learned that the slave had hanged himself. And Raymond thankfully praised God for the mercy, for having taken the decision from him to kill that slave. That is one story. The other story is Ignatius of Loyola. That's about almost 200 years, a bit more than 200 years later. Ignatius of Loyola, when he was a knight errant and was a zealous young converted Christian, traveled through somewhere in Spain and met a Muslim who was a doctor, and came into conversation with him, and eventually at one point Muslim made some mocking remarks about St. Mary being a virgin. Ignatius, soldier, irascible, got pretty mad at him, and their ways parted, and he was thinking of going after this Muslim to kill him. He was kind of hesitant, so he trusted God and let the reins of this horse, of his mule, I think, yeah, let the reins go and let the mule decide. And the mule decided to go the other way, and that spared the life of the Muslim. Both people, Raymond Lull and Ignatius, tell this story late in their life in their memoirs, in their autobiographical stories. That means to me, from the literary point of view, they thought that very important, this event, and also they thought it to be emblematic. My short summary of it is, don't kill Muslims. the point is, the virginity of Mary and the Trinity are the points of contention between the Muslims and the Christians, and that is also debated here in this text. Yeah, but you see before Raymond Lowe, Nicolas of Cusa, 100 years before Nicolas of Cusa, and again 100 years after Nicolas of Cusa, the message is the same. There are differences between between the religions, but that's not a reason to kill each other. Yeah. Okay, that's just an aside. So then follows the Jew, and again the Jew speaks about the question of the fecundity of God. And let me see, there is a passage I think we should read. Let's see, where was it? Yeah. Just a second. Yeah. I can read that. This discussion with the Jew ends the following. Now, in the manner in which the Arabs and Jews deny the Trinity, assuredly it ought to be denied by all. But in the manner in which the truth of the Trinity is explained above, of necessity, it will be embraced by all. This is heavy stuff. He is saying, he has been debated how debating how the Jews and how the Muslims think about the Trinity as a contradiction in terms, as a philosophical problem, the theological problem. And he says, their arguments against the Trinity are valid arguments, because to see Trinity that way would be a misunderstanding. But if they understand the way I, Nicolas of Cusa, just explained it, actually it is, let me see, is it still Peter? No, it's Jesus himself. The way Jesus himself is explaining the Trinity, that is acceptable to also the Muslims and also the Jews. Yeah. So this gives another quality to the question of the compatibility of the religions. Yeah. A misinterpreted Christian faith is not worth following, but we have to understand that misinterpretations of Christian faith are possible also within Christianity. You know, in the manner in which Arabs and Jews deny the Trinity, it should be denied by all, including the Christians. Yeah, and in the way, in a philosophical interpretation, as he has given before, including the question of fecundity, of creativity, that is possible. That is, the divergence. The divergence and the concordance of the religions can be on the same level, or they make religions compatible. Then follows Eschetian, an interpretation of Christian belief in terms of Neoplatonic emanation. Then follows a French, who introduces the question of incarnation. Here now starts the debate about incarnation, about Christology. I don't know why it is a French. I guess it is a theologian of Paris, but I'm not quite sure. That is something someone should look very carefully at the wordings. Then follows a Persian who is speaking on behalf of the Arabs, and makes a very interesting claim about minority and majority. Let me see, that is end of section 41. Yeah. Now St. Peter is speaking. The sect of the Arabs, which is large, still confesses that Christ resurrected the dead and created birds from clay. And there are many other things which they expressly confess Jesus Christ to have done. From these, they can quite easily be led further. So he is taking a standard argument of the critique of the Quran and Cusanus himself wrote a Crivatio al Corani, an interpretation of the Quran, in which they showed, look, that's what they accept about Christian tenets, but that's what they get wrong, and that's what they get wrong, and that's what they get wrong, and so on. And he's taking it up and says, but everything they say correctly about Christ can be a step or a lead, a gateway to a correct understanding, a full understanding of Christianity. And that is the notion of manductio that Gergely Bokos has elaborated on in his dissertation. So then the Persian says, the Arabs can affirm of Christ these and many other things which are written in the Quran. However, to bring the Jews to believe any of this will be more difficult than others, since the Jews do not expressly admit anything regarding Christ. And then St. Peter says, in their scriptures they have all these teachings regarding Christ, but they follow the literal meaning and refuse to understand. However, this resistance of the Jews will not impede harmony, for they are few in number and will not be able to trouble the whole world by force of arm. That is one of the instances that I mentioned, you know, that all of a sudden, very practical ideas come in, you know. Religion is also a matter of numbers. Yes? And we have to face it. And Cusanus faces it. You know, it's also a matter of numbers. Yeah. But of course, the doctrinal questions are the more important ones. Let me see the... then is a very interesting passage later on 43. St. Peter says, so if faith holds this, then in some man human nature is united previously to the divine nature, that is, in that man who is the countenance, who is the face of all nations, and is the most high Messiah and Christ, as the Arabs and the Jews call Christ. So this is a kind of a garbled sentence. I hope I can unpack it. There must be human nature. The human nature must be in some man previously to the divine nature, and that is, there is one man who is the face of all nations and the most high Messiah and Christ. So he now interprets, and that is typical, you find that also in his Doctor Ignorantia and elsewhere, for Nicolas of Cusa, Christ is the epitome of humanity. Christ is neither just an extraordinary man, Christ is not in any other sense an only God. The twofold nature of Christ means God. Christ is what man is, or what a human being is, or at least the potential of a human being. Yeah. And in that sense, the incarnation is real, has to be real, but at the same time it is symbolical and paradigmatic. So and that's why he is banking on a passage in some Arabic scripture where it is said that Christ is the face of all nations. Yeah. Which I think is a pretty interesting thing. And consequently then, Christ is also the source or the stronghold of peace, because it keeps all nations together, because it is humanity and it is Christ, the figure of Christ, that unites them all. Let me see, the Spaniard brings up the question of the virginity. The Turk speaks about the death and ascent to heaven, and then follows towards the end, the German, who speaks about a promise and desire, a dialectical relationship. There is no desire without a promise, and there is no promise with an inborn desire of humans. And the desire is also the desire for immortality, the desire for salvation. Yeah, and so he, following the lead that Christ is the epitome of being human, the desire of salvation and the promise of salvation and the desire for salvation is built in Christ and therefore in the humans. It then follows the Tatar who speaks about the ordinary people again, the Armenian who speaks about baptism rituals. There is a question about circumcision that could be interesting, and the Bohemian then speaks about the two forms of communion of Eucharist, the body and the blood. The Bohemian, that is the Hussites, and who were still a topic at the Council of Basel that Nicolas of Cusa attended. Yeah, and then the Englishman, I believe it should be a Lollard or something, who concludes this round of discussant. And he speaks again about the disturbances of all religions. Let me just briefly find this passage. Here it is. There is speaking about marriage and holy orders and confirmation and all kinds of sacraments, and St. Paul says, "It is necessary to make great allowances for the weakness of men, unless doing so is in conflict with eternal salvation. For to seek exact conformity in all respects is rather to disturb the peace. Nevertheless, we must hope that with regard to marriage and the holy orders, a harmony may be found." So, once again, conformity is, the quest for conformity is the source of quarrels and of war. So while on the one hand, the presupposition of unity, of oneness, the existence, the presupposition of there is a God, is the means to achieve peace of religion, That same unity, misunderstood, is the source of religious war. And then follows this fabulous conclusion. Paul suggests, where conformity of mode cannot be had, nations are entitled to their own devotions and ceremonies. Yeah, this is a total sellout of all traditional claim of the necessity for salvation of certain rituals. Yeah, that's what we can say. Yeah, I knew a Jesuit, and we came into discussion with a person who was an ardent. Adherent of Medjugorje, of the presence of Our Lady in Medjugorje, back then Yugoslavia. And this guy was talking, and he was so excited about it, and the Jesuit said, was calmly sitting there, listening, friendly, and said, "But it's not a de fide. It's not a matter of faith." Yeah. Where conformity of mode cannot be had, nations are entitled to their own devotions and ceremonies, provided faith and peace are being maintained. Yeah. Now we understand that faith is the problem and peace is the problem. And the problem is to get both of them together. So eventually we would have to say, And that can also be related to current events. If we understand faith correctly, and if we struggle for peace seriously, then these details don't matter anymore. Yeah. And then he says, perhaps as a result of certain diversity, devotion will be even increased. He returns to this idea, since each nation will endeavor with zeal and diligence to make its own right splendid, in order that in this respect it may excel some other nation, and to obtain greater merit with God and praise in the world. And then it concludes the last lines, therefore in the heaven, in Zölorationis, in the heaven of reason or of mind, a harmony among the religion was reached. Zölorationis is a term that comes up in Cusanus in several places, and what he means is there is a realm of transcendence that is accessible to humans, in which certain problems solve themselves. And this is one of these. And it is a heaven, because it is not earthly. But it is also reasonable. It is also accessible to the human mind. And therefore, he says, if we refer the problem of religion, the atrocities, the wars, the quarrels, the petty quarrels and the big fights, if we refer them to the realm of non-earthly reasonability, we come to a very easy, we come to a practical conclusion of our fights. Sorry, I was talking a long time, and I think I stop at this point and invite you to make comments or objections or raise questions or discuss with each other. Thank you for your patience.
So, to come back to the statement of one religion and a variety of rights, it seems sort of to say at a practical level you can allow for certain diversity, even says nations are entitled to their own rituals. I struggle with that because I think there are certain rituals that are individuating, there are certain rituals that are dividing, there are certain rituals that promote violence. You know, I can think of like Aztec religion, for instance, at one point where they were sacrificing human beings. You know, like is that a proper sense of diversity? I mean, how would Cusa deal with even in today where ritual is just, you know, multiplied by a billion when you have personal religion and individual religion and all those kinds of problems? I don't know if you could comment on that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let us address your question from a secular, strictly secular point of view, and then from a religious point of view. Yeah, I think that might help. From a secular point of view, what would be objectionable to sacrificing people for the for religious reasons? It seems to be obvious that we are against it. Yeah. If I look at the faces, yeah. Let's think about it. You know, what makes it objectionable, Lisa?
Yeah, because it instrumentalizes certain people for the good of other people. That is, it is a sacrifice, not of the people sacrificed, but of the people sacrificing. That is, it makes a division between people who act and profit and people who only suffer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we would say that there is no instance there is no higher level that could be justifiably, say, in, out?
Only if you are not thinking in terms of individualism and individuality. If you are thinking in terms of people, then human sacrifice is the best thing you can do.
In you mean
if it's a people, against who sacrifices,
mm-hmm.
Then it's all right. Then it's the best thing you can sacrifice, and therefore it's the best thing to do. It's almost obligatory. But if you think of the sacrificed person, as an individual, mm-hmm. then it's not okay.
Yeah, okay.
Maybe a very simple example. I mean, in Duce et decorum est pro patria mori, isn't that the kind of sacrifice that secular states are very willing to accept? Even though, I mean, the technicality is, of course, different than from monastic human sacrifice, but the idea for sending thousands of our members into war with a certain death, and it's necessary for the survival of the state.
Sure. Yeah, well, we know this proverb mostly from Erasmus's critique of it. that's a good point. But as a secular person, I would now say that, well, that is not something the king or the authorities can demand from someone. But it has to come from the individual who would say about himself, it is good to die for the fatherland.
In the draft.
I'm sorry.
People can be drafted.
Yeah.
The question is: can a draft be grounded on this motto? Can the Belgian government say it's good for you to die for this country?
It's necessary. And,
yeah, but the proverb is dulce et decorum. Sweet in the sense of acceptable or nice, and it is an honor to die for this country. I believe that. It's a good question. Until the middle of the 20th century, countries would have said that, but I believe it doesn't work anymore these days. Yeah.
I think it's very, very difficult to generalize about human sacrifice, because if we look at the facts, who are the people who were sacrificed, it's so diverse that you really cannot, make a statement. Our tendency to generalize on human sacrifice only shows that we are very, very far away from practicing it. Because who were sacrificed? Children, infants, virgins, soldiers, criminals and kings.
Yeah, but
and I think that if you just name these different social groups, you see how there is not one meaning, but a world of different meanings to the idea of human sacrifice. So it's very, very difficult or questionable to generalize upon it. And I think we can all say that the most abhorrent to us is the idea of sacrificing infants who have not lived their own lives and who are totally instrumentalized. But the idea that a certain situation in a country requires the sacrifice of the king is much less abhorrent to us because, well, a king is somebody who embodies power and who has in his own social standing a sort of sacral position, and he ought to be ready at a certain point in the most need of his country to pay the price for it.
But to come back to the original question, first of all, it makes a difference. I think it makes a difference whether a person is sacrificing himself or sacrificing others. Yeah, and of course, I would say very briefly that patriotism is a sort of religion, this motto is, of course, an expression of a version of our patriotism. So the question, from a secular point of view, say if I were Christopher Hitchens, I would say, you see, that's what religion does. Yeah, and it is, of course, bad to kill any person, and it's certainly bad to kill a person only for religious motives. Yeah, that would be a secular position. A position that is sympathetic with religion would probably say that we get the point, because it is about pleasing the gods. It is certainly about building community, because even this killing of members of the community, or maybe even of slaves or of captives of war, is a community enforcing act. And then in the next step, we would say, can't you think of something else? Yeah, I probably would say that Cusano's approach would certainly be, they have a very important idea in mind, namely that sacrifice is possible. That sacrifice means to refer to a higher authority, to divinity, that is more important than the earthly life. But then there are things that are going wrong, and we would say, no, from a Christian point of view, we would say, self-sacrifice, yes, but sacrifice as a passive experience is no good. So that's along the lines, I would guess that Nicolas of Cusa would argue.
I might just add that, I mean, his whole approach seems very rationalistic. So we'll start out with a particular belief, and then sort of reason back and forth, and then lo and behold, there's a rational explanation which happens to be identical with kind of Christian one. But in the case of idolatry is an example of a right that he takes up at a certain point, and then he doesn't really, at least I don't recall him attacking it as such, but first he basically shows why it doesn't make sense. So I don't know if you'd call this more religious or secular, but with the question of sacrifice, he said, well, is the sacrifice actually going to keep the sun rising every day? No, that's absurd, so there's no point in doing it. And then maybe you need to supply some other premises for whether it's right or wrong. But.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but sacrifice leads us back to the notion of religious war, because, religious war is a means of excelling in self-sacrifice. And if the enemy does not come and kill me for my religion, I go and kill him. So he will be forced to kill me for my religion. I think that, jihad is, first of all, a way of self-sacrifice. And even now we see all those suicide attacks. The notion is primarily to die for one's religion and to kill for one's religion is a means to achieve this goal, to die for one's religion.
On a funny note, you might have seen that when speaking about the promise for the life after, and that is something that seems to be seriously entertained by the suicide bombers these days, is that according to the Quran, those who die, sacrifice themselves, will be rewarded with all kinds of pleasant things, including women with black hair and black eyes. And then it says, which I find pretty funny, when they said, no German would like that. there are other passages in Cusa's works where you can see that he is very conscious of being a German, and as a German being weird, being an outsider, in the Italian culture. And so, and even in this Concordantia Cattolica, he says, I know we Germans don't speak well Latin, we don't write nice Latin, but bear with me, that's what I have to say. Yeah. So, coming back to this thing, we have to recognize that those who seriously commit suicide for the sake of religion do acknowledge salvation, reward, a heaven, an afterlife, and so, and that is all positive stuff to work with, And so instead of just saying, no, that's bad and that is cruel and that is and those are criminals and people who should be shot by us before they kill themselves, we should recognize if it is true religion, it is still true religion, and it presupposes something we Christians agree upon. That there is an afterlife, that there is an afterlife that is also a life with reward, punishment for what has been done in this world. And then we can debate about whether it is correct to kill other people by killing themselves, or whether even suicide is acceptable. But Cusanus would in that case immediately say, look, there's still a common denominator in that.
I have a question regarding the role of faith in religious studies, Cusanus sees it, because it seems obvious to me that his idea of faith, of the content of faith, is particularly and exclusively Christian. And it also seems quite obvious to me that Muslims and Jews generally do not accept the Trinity or Christology, even as Zanus envisions it. And how would that for Cusanus be a problem for religious peace? Because it seems implied that it is. You mentioned that, it's okay to have different rights as long as faith, as everyone believes the same thing. And believing the same thing means believing the Trinity and believing that Christ is divine. So what if other religions actually do not believe that? And related to that, he says that there is no problem with the Jews because they are numerically small and they have no weapons, right? Suppose the Jews one day would not be numerically small or have weapons. The latter is the case, actually. Why would that be a threat to peace?
From the way I understand the Cusanus, he's arguing that the divergence on theological matters is not that deep. That there is a reason to have a deep rift between the Jews, the Muslims, and the Christians. That is one thing. But of course, you could say there are still, no-goes, that like to give up the Trinity. But I believe Cusanus is going one step further and is actually inviting us to look at basic tenets of Christianity, and that is, say, everything that is comes after the preambula fide, that is, for instance, incarnation and Trinity, to look at that with the eyes of the others, with the eyes of the non-Christians. Yeah? And if you do that, you still keep a conversation going.
Yeah, but he doesn't really do that. He projects a kind of pseudo-Christianity on his partners in the dialogue.
Yeah, that's a common accusation of Cusanus, that he's basically he has this presupposition theory that is, they do not know that they actually are Christians, and I am just helping them to understand that. Karl Rahner coined then in the 20th century the term anonymous Christians, you know, for people who behave Christian, who think in a Christian way but don't profess to be Christians. And that is always a very ironic move, and that is for sure. But I would say, yeah, the best I can say is Cusanus is inviting us to look at the Christian religion from the point of view of a non-Christian and see what of that, how much of that makes sense and how far it goes that it can be compatible.
Yeah, I think that's also, well, there's also two ways of making peace. And one I would call the Unitarian way, that is, just forget about everything that divides us, and what will remain will be nothing, and we can be very peaceful if we all bring with nothing. Well, there are stages before that, and one of those stages I would say is the Unitarian Church, before believing in nothing. And I think that Cusanus doesn't want this. He wants to stay a Christian, but in a way that he concedes to a Muslim that he wants to stay a Muslim unless he is convinced, really and personally convinced, of something else, and then he may convert. So he's not throwing away the differences, but he is transcending them, which is different. That is, he is reasonably transcending the differences, finding the point where the unity can be achieved. But of course, this point in itself is not enough, because we don't want an abstract face, we want a concrete face. And that's the difficulty. He cannot cease to be a Christian. And therefore, I think this interpretation is not quite just, that he wants everybody to be Christians. As a Christian, he is seeking for the point of unity, but dialectically, he must remain connected to the concreteness of his faith and of his devotion as a Christian. And this is, of course, well, very difficult to express, and if it is expressed, also very difficult to understand.
Yeah.
I would have three thoughts. One concerning rites, rituality. There is also an asymmetry, a lack of symmetry between different religious traditions within, for instance, the Abrahamic religions. Because for Judaism, or outside that group, for Roman religion, rite is not putting in practice something, but in rites itself consists the substance. Why Christianity explicitly challenged this point, It is enough to read the gospel. There are statements against this point. The Saturday is made for the man and not the man for the Sabbath, etc. So there if we say in a diversity of rights, we have also to take into account that right has not the same weight according to different. This is just, it's not a question, it's just a remark, but it seems to me that it's important to make. The second concerns sacrifice. He died a few weeks ago, and to me, one of the most suggestive interpretation of the problem of sacrifice is René Girard's reading, and because it explains sacrifice, which is at the foundation of Christianity, is man's sacrifice, and also as the last possible sacrifice, because it denounced this scapegoat system and so on. It seems to me that Girard, by the way, vindicates that this is not a matter of interpretation, this is how fact works. So once you see it, you should accept. It seems to me that this is important to keep into the picture, that so long the mechanism of the scapegoat with the triangle, the escalation of competition until the maximum beatitude is not denounced, is impossible to avoid sacrifice. Then it could not take the form of the traditional sacrifice on the altar, but still. But it seems to me that this is a strong claim, but it's easier to verify it than to falsify it if we look at what is happening now. Because this looking for the scapegoat is the first reaction after these recent happenings was exactly to identify the scapegoat. It was the first speeches were all in those directions. And my third thought is a more controversial, and if you want a name that could be the background of my idea is Marcel Gauchet. The idea that Christianity has in itself, there is a bad secularization, which is a denial of Christianity, but there is also secularization, which is the coming through of what Christianity is in itself, including the most abrasive of scandalous part, like the very topic of the death of God, is a Christian topic. In no other religion has the same place. So these are elements that in different, at least the first and the third, conspire for making this conversation among religion a very problematic one. And the last comment on my third point, becoming true of a message. The question of truth is crucial in Christianity, not in the same way as in other philosophical traditions. Religious tradition. In many religious traditions, truth is not an issue, is something out of it. For Christianity, truth is in it. And so also the relation with Judaism or with Islam is of course different, because with Judaism there is the problem you stress, namely, okay, we are from a vantage point that we can explain your right, but we are more right than you because you are a part of our larger truth. This could be not welcome for those who are considered less with a shorter sight, but still is a very is a model that you can work with. Think of hermeneutics, of the different horizon that could integrate, giving time. But in the case of Muslim, there is a clear claim in the Quran according to which the former revelation are incomplete and contains falsity. There is no claim in the New Testament that the Old Testament contained falsity. Once it is good interpreted, it's completely true. If someone comes to say, not only you do not see from my vantage point, but you are really blind and you are unable to see, that's, of course, is much more difficult to use the category of truth, even in a very sophisticated hermeneutical system, because one of the two, the level of recognitions are not compatible.
Yeah, if I may say a few things. First of all, yeah, thanks for reminding us of René Girard. What René Girard describes is what Cusanus would call a custom. That is a tension that is a theoretical and conceptual tension in a society becomes becomes petrified or becomes enacted in certain actions of a society, including the scapegoating. And that leads me to the other question, and that's another answer to your question. And that means it's not that much that Cusanus is Christianizing the Muslims and the Tatars and whoever. The problem is that it seems to be the power of Christian religion to elevate or to take the practical, the life situation on a theoretical level and make it therefore also communicable. That's why Christianity is successful as an international, inter-ethnic religion. And that is a move that is not necessarily shared by all religions and all societies. If a society is strictly in favor of ritualizing theoretical problems, like say a mad person does certain compulsory acts because it is actually solving a mental problem. Yeah. So if a society, if a community is ritualizing the theoretical tensions they have, or tensions that could be described theoretically, but solving them with practical actions, like, for instance, sacrificing, like ostracizing, like creating class distinctions and so on, these would not be able, or they would not be favorable to the typical Christian move that probably started with St. Paul, the question about circumcision between St. Peter and St. Paul, and which is also alluded to in this text. It is here St. Paul who says, no, circumcision is only circumcision is a symbolic act, and therefore it is also acceptable for those who believe in who need the circumcision as a visible act of a certain faith. So, back. The tension could be that Christianity is a religion that tends to be abstract, tends to be theorizing, and is always in a dialectical relationship between practice and theoretical theology, whereas there might be religions that are fundamentally opposed to this move. Yeah? On the contrary, they express theoretical problems in practical things, and if they cannot express them in practical things, then something is missing. That would be the idea that comes from me from your comments. You had a question.
Yeah, but I forgot.
This conversation. So it was eclipsed by Andrea.
Yeah, it was.
I'm sorry.
I had a question about the apophatic theology. I'm by no means an expert on anything, philosophy or theology. But I was wondering, so if I understand it well, in this kind of theology, God's nature is everything every characteristic he has. Is brought up to the level of the absolutes. So basically, for him, there would be no difference between good or evil. It's so absolute, it's the same thing.
Yeah, go ahead.
So we talked about peace here. So for God, there would be no difference between peace and war.
Yeah. let me think about it. And anyone who wants to chime in, yeah. So probably we would have to say that.
Well, but there is no contradiction in God, which means that there is no war, because war presupposes difference.
Say if. No, if you can show that war in and of itself is a contradiction in terms, or a contradictory act, a performative contradiction. Yeah, if you could show that, then you could also show that this is not possible in God. But the standard moves, for instance, with theodicy, that is the justification of God in the face of the existence of evil, the standard move is always that from God's point of view, this evil is not an evil, but it is just a shortcoming of what is fundamentally good. That is the argument by Augustine. In God there is no contrast between good and evil, and Aquinas' turn of it is God can turn evil into good. You understand? So from that point of view, you could say in God evil and good are not a contradiction. But of course, eventually then they are both good, you know. So it wouldn't go that far. But the other part of your argument is, of course, that God as the creator of a finite world is, of course, also the one who is responsible for the existence of contrasts and of shortcomings. And that is also said at the beginning, if I find the passage, where basically there is finger pointing and said, you screwed it up. Let me see. You who are hidden God, accordingly, you set over your people different kings and different seers and called prophets, very many of whom, in their role as your legates, instituted in your name worship and laws and instructed an uneducated people. Men accepted these laws just as you yourself, the King of Kings, had spoken them to them face to face. They believed that they heard not kings and prophets, but you yourself, and in and through kings and prophets. Now, to various nations you sent various prophets and teachers, some at one time, others at another, but the earthly human condition has the characteristic that is long-standing custom, which is regarded to have passed into nature, and is defended as truth. So the speaker is basically accusing God of having created the mess by creating a variety of peoples, of nations, and by creating a variety of prophets and priests and messengers, and so that then people by custom hold to their religions, and so eventually, yes, God himself is to blame for that.
He would not be aware of that.
Okay, we are speaking about a vision of a discussion in heaven, in which the heaven is basically that the realm of theoretical reason is debating with itself, how is it possible that we have this problem? Yeah, and the answer is, it is inherent in God being the creator of a finite world and of a variety of peoples. Yeah, so in that sense, say figuratively, God has been made aware of the problems he had created.
I think maybe we would have time for one more comment if there is one.
Maybe I'll make a little comment.
Yeah, please.
But just from a purely historical point of view, you see, because I have this feeling that Christianity really has almost never been able to deal with Islam. It's always been a very big problem. Christians have been able to convert peoples all over the world, but
with great difficulty deal with Islam, but two situations occur to my mind. One is that some nations, in spite of being conquered by Islam or Islamic rulers, still kept their faith. So I think of, most Indians, so 80% of Indians are still today Hindus, even though they were ruled for 300 years by Islamic emperors and persecuted a whole population of Delhi, killed and so on. And also the peoples of Georgia and Armenia, who kept their Christian faith even though they were ruled by Persia. Mm-hmm. But the other historical example I'm thinking of is where Christians really did something, but I don't know if it was very Christian, and that was to drive the Muslims out of France and then finally out of Spain. Mm-hmm. But how Christian was it?
Yeah, according to the double sword theory, that was Christian, because God has given the Christian authority, the Christian kings, the military sword, and also the missionary sword, the sword of the spirit. And if the one doesn't work, then the other helps. That at least was the theory around the time of Raymond Lull, and But it is Lull himself who is undermining this theory with the emphasis on conversion, on rationalization. And that was also, of course, in Raymond Lull, the strategy, again, to come back to this theoretizing. You know, he was optimistic that there is a theoretical level on which he can converse with Muslims about the attributes of God and so on. In logical terms, and by this convert them. What he eventually did is he contributed to the invention of computers, but not didn't convert anybody. You know. The interpretation, whether that is Christian or not, that's a good thing. But according to Nicolas of Cusa, I would say no, it wouldn't be. It wouldn't work, and maybe symbolically. He died in 1464 on his way to a crusade he actually didn't want.
Well, with that, I think we should say thank you very much for very, very interesting.
Yes, thanks for coming. Oh, wonderful, thanks.
Just three little announcements. Our next
think chocolate, yeah.
Our next film will be a film night next Thursday night at 7:30. We'll be showing Calvary, an Irish film which came out from last year. Thereafter, our last event of the semester is Professor Henning Tiefmeyer's talk, Why Christianity Needs Metaphysics. That's Wednesday, the 16th, I believe, of December. Uh-huh. And then if there are any questions or topics for discussion further on, our habit is to head over to Universum or another bar to continue the discussion, so you're welcome to join whoever is interested. Thank you once again.
Thanks. Remind me of this talk by Tegmeyer.
Okay.
Thanks for coming.
Herzlichen Dank.
Ja, vielen Dank.
Heißt die Wahl? Nein, nicht. Ich mache es nicht.